Hello, everybody. So my name is D.Schlesinger. I am from Dresden, from Computer Vision Lab. Let me just start. The question is how to model families of probability distributions you like to work with. So it's not about learning or particular models or applications. It's just a kind of high-level considerations. Basically, there are two ways to do it currently, the called generative and discriminative models. So let me spend a few words about what is what. Generative statistical models mean basically you have joint probability distribution. To some extent, it means that you model the whole world. For each elementary event of your world, for each pair observation x, some prediction label y, and some model parameter, you have just a number. In contrast, discriminative models are motivated by the fact that at the end, if we learn our model, what we need for inference is only the posterior probability distribution. So the approach is just to decompose our joint into constituents, just prior for observation times posterior for hidden, depending on observation, and just forget about P of X, since it's not interesting, it's not relevant for inference. So in this case, we model the whole world. Our model assign one value for each elementary event. So in this case, we model only a part of it somehow, only what we need for inference. It's known from the literature some drawback advantages of these two approaches. For instance, it's known that discriminative models are more overfitting. Usually you need more data to reliably train these models. On the other hand, discriminative models are easier to design. What does it mean? You can put any feature you like though, in your discriminative model and just build some probabilistic model on top of it. Okay, good. And now the aim is to design some approach that is something is between, neither generative nor discriminative. It means we would not like to model the whole world, to assign probability value for each elementary event, but we would not like to completely forget about P of X, to make this more robust. Let me present a sketch where such a relation between generative and discriminative is more or less explicitly drawn. Imagine we have some family of joint probability distributions. So one point in the circle is just one probability distribution. What we do at generative learning, we just search for one point inside the set according, for instance, to the maximum likelihood. Let's imagine another family of all posterior conditional probability distributions that can be derived from this family. So, of course, for each joint there exists one conditional. So there is a mapping and there is corresponding family for posterior probability distribution that is, in some extent, correlated to the set of joints. In generative modeling, we search for a point here. And then, having this point, we just invert our probability model to get posterior. We derive posterior from a point from join. If we are working with discriminative model, we just forget about joint probability distribution and work directly with this family, optimizing, for instance, conditional likelihood. The crucial point, what is done during this transfer, that you forget about prior probability distribution for observations. Basically, if you have such a family, then there exists indeed some family of marginal probability distribution, P of X, that can be obtained by marginalization of this member over Y. So it means this family is restricted, it's not arbitrary. If you go this direction, you just forget about this family. Now let's do some step back. Let's imagine a family of joint probability distributions whose posteriors are inside the set. It means we enlarge the family of joint probability distribution. If we think, what does it mean, how huge is the set, is extremely huge. Basically, the set of all probability distributions over X. If X, for instance, is an image, then what does it mean? The dimensionality of this family is the number of all possible images. So this family is extremely sparse, this family is extremely huge. If you have just two learning samples, then, so if you work with discriminative models, then implicitly you are working with this huge family of joint probability distribution. You just optimize your joint likelihood within this huge set. And this is the main source for overfitting. If you have two training samples, then you can land in this family arbitrarily far from each other to some extent. So there is no guarantee that you land somewhere here close to each other with corresponding posteriors. Okay, if you are working with generative models, you always, so to say, project so your results onto this set with basically subspace. So this family has some finite dimensionality. This is just number of your free parameter of your system. So it can be, of course, 1,000, it can be, yeah, many, but it's not the number of the image in the world. So it's some subspace. Now the aim is to design an approach to be able to define some families of probability distribution that are not as restricted as the generative ones, but more restricted than discriminative ones, something in between, something like that. So some family of probability distribution that are in between somehow. How to do it? The key idea is the following. Let's repeat all this consideration, but in another way around. Let's consider the family of conditional probability distributions, X under the condition Y. We will call this forward models or generating model, observation model. Now let's consider the family of all joint probability distribution having this appearance model. So these two sets are overlapping, and our target family of probability distribution is just this intersection. What does it mean? In our approach, we do not specify joint probability distribution. We do not model the whole world completely, first. Secondly, so it's not generative model. We do not specify conditional, this posterior probability distributions only, so it would be discriminative model. We specify a family of posterior probability distribution somehow, and a family of forward models. And these two family of conditionals gives you such implicitly specified set of joint probability distribution. And then the maximum likelihood would think, although you just look for a best probability distribution within the set. So let me formalize it a bit. So basically, this is formal definition. What does it mean? We have two families of conditional probability distribution, X under condition Y, Y under condition X. So, and a joint probability distribution, which is parameterized by Bose parameter from Bose, is defined as there exists model in the first family, model in the second family, some marginal probability distribution for X, marginal probability distribution for Y, so that just satisfy these constraints. So X times Y under condition X is Y times X under condition Y. So it holds for all possible value for all X, Y. There is some small problem. So in practice, we would not like to care about joint probability distribution at all. We would not like to specify it somehow and to derive the corresponding families of conditionals. We would like to design two families of conditionals that fit our application. We would like maybe to use some neuronal network, so for prediction. or decision forest, or whatever predictor you like. So some posterior model for this, some family of posterior models known up to the unknown parameters. Then for this part we may use, though I do not know, so again, something you prefer with particular application, yeah, some rendering engine from game industry, or so in medical images, they are very good forward models. They know exactly how their microscope works, so up to the last photon, how it is. Okay, so it means we do not like to consider this joint. We like to specify these two family and work with this family of probability distribution given implicitly. But there is a problem. If you design just arbitrary family of conditionals, it may be the case that the corresponding intersection is just empty. There you have nothing to learn. To alleviate this problem, we weaken a little bit this condition, this original conditional. It should hold for all x, y values. We demand not we do not demand that it holds for all value, but only if you marginalize over y this expression, then you will get x. If you marginalize over x, you will get y. So this is, of course, weaker condition. If this holds, then this holds automatically. But it's not necessarily, if this holds, this not necessarily holds. So this weaker condition, and the family of probability distribution satisfying this condition, we call it weak implicit modeling. So now it's true that for each pair of conditional probability distribution, no matter how they are designed, it can be absolutely heterogeneously. One may be some neuronal network, the other may be some Gaussian mixture or whatever. It doesn't matter at all. If there are no zeros in this conditional probability distribution, then there exist exactly two joint probability distributions satisfying this equation. Okay, so this is good news, so you can work with it. And it turns out this weak modeling is in fact a generalization. So let's consider such a situation. You, of course, you can design your families of conditionals as you want. So let's do the following. Let's design our prediction model, our posterior model, so that it just do not depend on observation. So for each value of y, this is one and the same. For each value of x, it is one and the same probability distribution over y. What does it mean? It means that we have basically p of y times some non-trivial px under the conditional y. It will be the yx of y that will be generative model, the classical generative model. So this axis corresponds to weakness of your family. So from independent probability distribution to discriminant function somehow, if this is deterministic. So, and something in between in some non-trivial cases. So, discriminative models occupy just a very small area at this, along this axis, and currently generative models occupy a very small area along this axis. And the aim is to explore the whole range of probability models. So especially our goal is to get some powerful modern discriminative models and push them into this direction. So it means to cope with overfitting, basically, to be able to learn this model from less data. Okay, so let me explain very briefly how to learn this model. So we follow maximum likelihood principle, so we optimize joint likelihood. There is a problem, of course. So let's consider just one example, some pair xy, and you'd like to optimize probability of xy under theta 1, theta 2, also these two parameters from both families. This is p of x plus logarithm p of y under the conditional x. As for the second term, it's easy because you have just an expression, just a formula. You can derive this formula, build gradient, and go the direction of gradient. It's standard approach. Also, if it would not be here, it would be just conditional likelihood. So, but here we have logarithm of p of x, and the problem is we have no explicit formula for that. We know there exists one marginal probability distribution over X, but we cannot do derivation. We have no formula for that. So this gradient is kind of problematic. But it's possible indeed. So the key idea is following. We model P of X as stationary distribution of some Markov chain that alternately generates between X and Y given current probability distribution. So basically the idea is as follows. All you need to do in order to compute gradient is to sample, to draw samples from joint and compute some sufficient statistics. So, and it's possible to draw samples from joint without having explicit formula for that. These two conditionals are enough in order to sample for joint. And if you can do so, you can just compute your sufficient statistics, you can compute gradient, stochastic gradient in this case, and optimize the thing. Good. About algorithm, and here are some results. And so I am computer vision guy, so we apply all the thing for, in this case, for binary segmentation. The algorithm for computing stochastic gradient looks as follows. Let's suppose we have our training examples, just image and binary segmentation we'd like to obtain. We have to sample labeling, to sample segmentation according to our current posterior model from this image. Then we have to sample image from this labeling according to our forward model, and then make it once more, sample again labeling according to our posterior model from this generated image. So, and the gradient obtained in the following way. So we have image. Currently, our posterior generates this, but it has to generate this. We just compute sufficient statistics for these two samples. Difference of sufficient statistics is a gradient. Compute gradient, go. So it's pretty simple. You have just to generate. So, and basically, it gives some hint what families of probability distribution you can model with this approach. It's only necessary that you are able to sample from this probability, from this conditional probability, and you only need to compute the gradient of the log likelihood for this image, also with this model. So then you can apply it. There are some experiments. I just skip. They just confirm our assumption. This experiment for semantic segmentation. So, yeah, if you are interested, maybe we can discuss offline the things. Okay, let me conclude. There are positive points. So this model, this modeling approach, implicit modeling, is generalization. So the usual discriminative and generative model are special cases. We can combine advantages of this model approaches. Hopefully, also we hope do not combine their drawback as well. Okay. Good, you can combine nearly any different heterogeneous probability distribution, any prediction model with any forward model. It's very good news. Good, negative points. At the moment, it's quite slow. It's based on sampling, so it takes for something about 100 images days of computation time. You have to sample labelings from given posteriors. It's very, very time-consuming process, although it's not applicable at the moment. So, to-do list, there are still some open questions. Although theoretically, the algorithm I presented is a kind of, there is an assumption behind, a reasonable one, but it's not exactly the algorithm you would like to have to optimize the joint maximum likelihood. There are some open questions. I would be glad to discuss them with you. Thank you very much, and help me please with questions.